I'm going to talk today about the evolution of craniofacial changes in the blind Mexican cavefish. And if you were here earlier, you would have heard another cavefish talk. So they're really cool organisms for studying not just the evolution of traits, but also kind of a cool evolutionary model for human disease, which a really great cavefish group is currently working on. And so the cave environment is very interesting. It is not super common for organisms to be able to colonize these environments because they're extremely dark. They vary, but many of the caves will have complete pitch black darkness and varying amounts of food. And when animals are able to invade these caves, they converge on kind of stereotypical features. And so this cave organism here has completely lost its pigmentation relative to its surface relative. In our system, the blind Mexican cavefish, they actually will start to develop an eye that then regresses. And so shortly after development, the eye will start to recede. But it's not just about loss. So cave organisms actually are able to gain traits as well. And so this is the lateral line system of the cavefish. And you can see that these sensory neuromast structures have actually been able to invade that eye, that empty eye socket. And so these creatures are able to expand their sensory system. And so this is the system that we work on, Asteanax mexicanus. So within the same species, we have two very different looking fish. So this is a surface dwelling fish that you can see in rivers surrounding cave networks. And we have many populations of cavefish that we're able to study. And so this being a comparative biology session, that's really what we do, is we compare between these two very closely related fish to try and understand how evolution is occurring. And like Nick's presentation, we can actually use these as an evolutionary model for human diseases. And so our collaborators and colleagues can study things like sleep loss, because you can imagine in a cave, they're not being exposed to complete darkness. You're not able to really get on a sleep schedule that we're really trained to. Retinal degeneration because of their eye loss. From Nick's excellent presentation, learning about how the metabolism changes when you have no food in the cave, how you're able to survive and thrive. Albinism, and then what we've really been interested in are craniofacial changes, understanding how changes to the skull may be related to some human disorders, such as cleft palate or different asymmetries that are common birth defects in humans. And so these are micro CT scans of both of our fish. So we have our surface dwelling fish and cave dwelling fish. And you can probably appreciate that the surface dwelling fish has this nice round eye orbit, while the cave fish has kind of this collapsed orbit. Other features you might notice are that the cave fish, or the surface fish, generally have this nice round skull where we get this more steeper slope in the cave fish skull. And then there are other bones that are really interesting in this fish. So even back to when these fish were first discovered in the 1930s, they noticed that there were changes to these suborbital bones that surround the eye. And so in cavefish in particular, I've been really interested in this bone here. It's called the suborbital number 3, or SO3. And it actually subfragments into multiple bony pieces. And so a lot of my studies and my PhD work have been trying to determine what is going on and why a bone would subfragment into multiple pieces. And so across this landscape map of Mexico and the mountain ranges where we find multiple caves, we see that in particular, as you go from north to south, even very geologically and phylogenetically distinct cave populations have this SO3 fragmentation happening. And if you look in a surface fish, both left and the right side, their SO3s are symmetrical in shape and size. But when you look at multiple cavefish populations, you see that they not only have fragmented bones, but they're also asymmetric. And so you can see varying numbers of bones on each side of the face, which we think is really interesting. So this is not just happening in one of the cavefish populations, it's happening over and over again. And so we were kind of interested to find out why this is happening. And to do that, we really had to look across life history. And so many studies focus on adults and very, very early in development. And so we were kind of interested in seeing what's going on in between over-ontogeny and the development of the cranium. So we started with the chondrocranium, or cartilage. So in juveniles about 1 week old, their skull is mostly just cartilage. And so we wanted to see if there were any changes associated with cavefish in their cartilage. And so we did this using geometric morphometrics, which is a shape analysis that you can do. So we set homologous landmarks. And we asked, are there any differences in the overall shape of the chondrocranium between surface fish and two distinct populations of cavefish, so it's not chondrocranium. And what we found is that there really aren't any shape differences. And so their shapes are overlapping here in this principal component analysis. So we thought that was really interesting. So early on in development, the shape of the chondrocranium is relatively conserved. And we also looked at asymmetry. So is the shape on the right side of the face the same as the shape on the left? And for surface fish, it is. And so the two shapes overlap. And very interestingly, the cavefish have overlapping right and left shape sides of their face as well. And so that contradicts what we see in adults, right? So you see a fragmentation of the SO3 bone is asymmetrical. But very early on in development, we're not seeing any evidence of shape difference or asymmetry. And so we moved on and looked at adults. We performed a similar analysis when we set landmarks on the skull in 3D because we had CT technology. And just to remind you, so this is what the chondrocranium looked like, where the shape was really overlapping across all populations. But that's not what it looks like in adults. And so the adult shape is segregated using the surface fish and the two populations of cavefish. So we thought that this might just be because of the landmarks that are set around the eye. So as that orbit's collapsing, that might be contributing to most of the shape variation. So we removed those, and we found the same result. So there are shape differences in the cavefish skull that are not just attributed to the shape of the orbit of the eye. So again, we wanted to not just look at shape, but also asymmetry or symmetry. And so doing that, we set landmarks again. We can reflect one side onto the other and compare the shapes of both right and left. And the data told us that there is a lot of lateral or bilateral asymmetry going on in the cavefish skull. So particularly in that SO3 bone that fragments, which is not surprising. The bone above the eye, the supraorbital, and even this bone, the empirical, that's posterior to the eye, have a lot of bilateral. And so we found that early on in the history of the cavefish, their skull is relatively conserved. It's not until later in the bone or in the osteocranium that we're starting to see these big differences in the skull. And so we wanted to know what's going on during the ossification of these bones that's changing between the surface of the cavefish. And so to do that, we just looked at the one bone, my favorite bone, the one that fragments, SO3 bone. And what we thought was going to happen was that for the surface fish, it would start as just a single ossification center that through development would grow out and become a normal bone. Based on some evidence from a paper in 2003 out of Bill Jeffries' group, we thought that we might see this evidence of secondary ossification centers, or these ectopic ossification centers that pop up. They never are able to fuse into that larger element and then become a fragmented bone. So to do this kind of life history analysis, we really wanted to keep the same individual alive the whole time. So we couldn't rely on clearing and staining or CT scanning. We had to follow a fish through their bone development. And we were able to do that using a chemical called calcein that binds to bony matrix. And so each of our individual cavefish were put into these 1 liter tanks, and they were able to swim, the happy cavefish swimming, in the calcein. And once a week, we, under fluorescent light, we imaged them and we were able to look at their bones. And so this is a surface fish bone growing over 50 weeks. So it takes kind of a while when they're put in that small of a tank. And you can see that indeed it does grow from the stable ossification center and very uniformly in shape. The cavefish, however, is a bit of a different story. So not only does it have secondary ossification centers, the most posterior secondary or ectopic ossification center is actually resorbed into the larger bone element, while one persisted as a fragment into adult. We also looked at symmetry, and so in the surface fish, the left and the right side grow very uniformly, shape and in size. In the cavefish, it was very interesting, and so we got differences in the number and the placement of secondary ossification centers, and then that kind of resulted in the asymmetry that we expected to see in adult. What was interesting to us is that when you look at the size of the bone over time, and so this speaks to this fertilization, the average area of this bone, based on the right and the left, we noticed that the cavefish, despite this fragmentation of this bone, had very symmetrical growth in terms of size. We actually saw a little bit more asymmetry in the surface fish. So that's kind of an interesting piece of the story, is that just normative asymmetry from developing on the right and the left. So that's something we're looking into as well. But if we revise our hypothesis now, we do see these secondary ossification centers that pop up very early in development. What was interesting is that some of these will resorb kind of during mid-development back into that larger bone, and then there will be a fragmented bone for any of these ossification centers that persist. So, seems like an open and closed case. Not so. Out of 30 fish that I looked at, only 4 of them had fragmented bones from this kind of mechanism. From the secondary ossification centers. And that is not what we would expect to see in adults when probably about 90 to 99% of our cavefish have fragmented bones. So there's another piece to this story. And as we kept looking at these fish over time, we noticed that there's an alternative mechanism for this fragmentation, and that is post-ossification bone remodeling. And so as a bone grows from week one, very early we started to see what appeared to be these notches at different points in the bone. And as you continue through development, notice that they indeed become get larger and become or carve out into separate bones. And so this post-ossification bone remodeling is what we think is really mediating this fragmentation. And you can see another example here where you get those notches and then a fragmented bone into many pieces. So again, we revise our hypothesis and show that there are 2 mechanisms that occur. And what's interesting is that within the fragment, we found bone remodeling cells, so osteoclasts, are here carving out that piece of bone. And then if you look at the ultrastructural level, in the fragment, you see pretty chewed up pieces of tissue, so like fibroblasts. So osteoclasts are really mediating. And just quickly, why would a bone fragment? We think that it might have something to do with neuromass, so this lateral line system that's expanded in cavefish. And you see these neuromass are around where these fragments occur. And we did an analysis where we found asymmetry in the number and position of neuromass on each side. So if you reflect one side onto the other, the position and number does not correlate. And that happens in not just one cavefish population, but and so just in conclusion, cranial asymmetry manifests later in the life history. There's 2 mechanisms, and the more common one is this post-ossification bone remodeling. And this may have something to do with the expansion of the sensory system in the cranial nerve mass, the location. And it could be a trade-off between sensory expansion and bone development. And so I'd like to thank my group, my advisor, Dr. Josh Gross, several undergrads, and I think maybe I can